Robertson. Oh, she's a heck of a lot of fun, Jeanne Robertson.
Well, right as we're starting, the clock is chiming. This is good. This is Jeanne Robertson. And are the pictures straight? I don't think the pictures are straight, but that's okay. We've straight. I think their pictures are crooked. I don't mean to be a real left brain person on you here, but a right brain person doesn't have to measure. A right brain person can just glance. And thank you, Pete. How about the one? This is the one that looks better than me.
I can't straighten that one from here.
I'll just pretend I'm stretching. Where is it? I can't. I'm moving backwards. Well, we'll do the best we can. Hey, y'all, this is Jeanne Robertson, and I'm not on my back porch, as you know. I am in Peg and Al McCree's living room because it's too cold to go outside in Nashville, Tennessee. Came here on New Year's Eve because I was on the Grand Ole Opry last night for a few minutes, and I'm back on tonight for maybe longer minutes. We never know. We'll see. We just keep laughing whatever's happening. And, oh, yes, look, Patrick Henry, this is an amazing thing. One of the questions y'all have been asking is, this is a question you've asked all, when this COVID calms down, am I going to be doing the Saturday shows that I'm doing? Like, because we've now been doing them since last March. We're into the 40s doing these shows. And we're trying to figure out how to do that because, remember, Patrick is not a person who hires out just to do the logistics and the computer stuff. He's a speaker. He's an entertainer. He just happened to live around the corner from me and has helped me with this. And so he will be on the road traveling, too. So we're about to figure this out because I'm in Nashville. I'm sitting here with Al and Peg McCree. Patrick is in my house in the green screen room. And he is also there is Tony, my assistant. So we're all running this show from doing it, and it's working fairly well. Are you there, Patrick? Ah, look at that. There you are.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. You know what? Okay, does everybody know? If you're typing, if you're at your computer, you can type right on my Facebook page and tell me what you might see that'd be a little bit different about Patrick. We'll give you do-do-do-do-do-do-do. Do you know what it is? Tony, have you gotten it on your computer yet?
I don't see it. Nobody's figured it out.
There he is.
There he is. He's shaved. Kathy Seville. He's shaved. You let it grow from Thanksgiving till Christmas, and everybody kept saying it's getting too long. It's getting too long. I like it. No beard, Gene Wiley. He has no beard.
Yay.
Yay. Yay. No beard. You said to all of us you were going to you're going to shave it after Christmas or the New Year's or whenever. When did you actually shave it?
We went down to see my mother in Auburn.
Oh.
And she was very good. She didn't mention it. But we got back and I told Leslie, well, on January 1st, I'm going to shave it. But once I got in my head that I was going to shave it, I felt like I had a raccoon on my face. And I just couldn't. I went straight upstairs and shaved it when I got home. So December 31st, I shaved
it. Okay, good for you. Now, they're asking me, this is a whole different way of doing things, this, and I'm going to go over that with it. Ann Walker said, no beard.
Yeah.
Remember Ann Walker, because we're going to talk about the Walkers in just a minute in South Carolina. but I've got such great questions, but I thought I'd spend a few seconds here in the beginning and tell you the big question everybody wanted to know was, did I make any resolutions? And I've always never made New Year's resolutions. Sometimes I try to make a new month resolution. That picture is not straight. That picture in the middle right there is crooked. It's as crooked as it. I'm going to do it. Ah, Matt, better. Now, if you'll notice, that one's crooked. We can't win. Patrick, click yourself back in the picture. I want to ask you, are you eating? Oh, and hey, Tony. Now, I left Thursday morning at 6:30 in the morning. And have we had any business? Have you done any business? Have you booked anything?
No,
it was New Year's Eve. I know it was New Year's Day.
Don't know if we booked anything. We're selling books, though, and we'll get them out. I just went to the post office and mailed a whole big bunch that came in Thursday and Friday, and now we'll get them out Monday if you get your orders in this afternoon.
Wait, did you say book?
Book. Okay, books or the audio book?
A combination of everything.
Good, because you get a percentage of the audio book. Is that correct, Patrick?
I believe it is.
I saw you eating something. What are you eating on the program? What is it?
No, I'm fueling.
What do you mean?
So Leslie has got me on a diet. And so we're allowed to eat every couple of hours, and it's some kind of real organized low calorie diet, but every couple of hours I have to eat something. So this is considered a meal.
Okay. Well, have you lost weight yet?
Well, I feel great. I've been on it for 2 hours, and she said I couldn't put Cheese Whiz on it, though.
Yeah, well, that's that.
Our big concern is what this does to our Sunday night dinners.
That's right.
Because I'm not sure they're going to be happy to cook for you and me and the kids when they can't eat.
When this COVID hit, they felt so sad for me and all that. Leslie and Patrick decided to say, we want you to come for dinner every Sunday night. That's the only people we can be around. We all have on masks. And I said, oh, well, okay. Now I've done that. And no, you're not going to be cooking the Sunday dinners anymore?
No, hold on for a second. Let me just correct the record. Leslie and I, it's hard to say no when you're standing there on our porch with a pot of beans on Sunday night.
Well, I did bring the baked beans. We love
having you. You're part of the family, and we've been doing the Sunday night. We always do Sunday night dinner, but over the when the pandemic hit, Jeanne jumped into our closed loop of people that we would associate with. We will do.
Well, Left Brain can't go, and I'm sitting there every Sunday night. And I said, well, I know they're eating over at the Henry's.
Well, Left Brain made it to plenty of dinners. And so anyway, we will find a way to continue Sunday night dinners, even if I have to lock myself in my bedroom.
Okay. Go ahead and eat your diet. Since we're on food, let me just get one thing clear here. The questions that I got, apparently, a lot of you have a tradition on New Year's Day of eating. What would y'all think?
Black-eyed peas, collard greens.
Collard greens. Well, we had a tradition in our family, too. My mother and father were from Auburn, Alabama, and Luverne, Alabama. And you had to have that pork. You had to have black-eyed peas. That was their tradition. I, however, do not eat black-eyed peas, not even one. As a matter of fact, Peg McCree is still hoping, look, on this plate right here is one black-eyed pea. And she thinks that during this show, I'm going to get so hungry that I reach over and eat this as some sort of a treat. It's not going to happen. She can do this, and I'll tell you why. Because when I was growing up, Mother would put one black-eyed pea on a plate, and it was a different era then. She said, we will sit here till you eat at least one black-eyed pea on New Year's Day, which I, as an adult, always said to my child, Beaver, you know, if you don't try it and if you don't like it, don't eat it. And it was a different way of thinking. And what made it worse was my sister Catherine loved black-eyed peas. So she'd be a big serving on her plate. Just, Mama, these are so good. Knowing I would throw up if I even looked at the black-eyed pea. And I'm not the only one. We have Christina Bingham Green says, I know it's a tradition in the South for people to eat black-eyed peas on New Year's Day. We don't eat them. The smell of cooking them makes my husband throw up or get sick or anything. And I just love your husband because I'm just like he is. Mother, though, in that era, in the 50s, we sat there. I would sit there 3 hours if I had to. And then what she started doing was trying to hide the black-eyed pea in the other food. So today, I have that one black-eyed pea. And when the opera was over last night, we came here for dinner. And Peg McCree had cooked, the Nashville people. She loves to cook, and she cooked, and made this big plate. And she said, let me just bring it to you. I was watching the football game. Let me just bring it to you. No, I'll get it. No, I'll bring it to you. And I thought, crossed my mind, she's hidden a black eyed pea in there. Peg, did you have a black eyed pea in there?
I did not.
Yeah, well, that's what you say, but you can put this one here. And when we finish this show, this black eyed pea with this fork is going to be still sitting on Peg McCree's thing right here like that.
Could I ask a question, Jeanne?
Yeah.
Are you saying black eyed pea or black eye pea? Because I've gotten to real debate with my good friend in South Carolina, Al Walker.
Ann Walker's brother.
We were sitting at a restaurant called Lizard's Thicket in Columbia, South Carolina, and we got into an argument whether it's black eye or black eyed. And I'd like to hear if anybody has an opinion about that.
Peg, you're the grammar person.
I looked it up. It's black eyed, E-Y-E-D, eyed.
She was a college professor. She was one of the editors on my book. I think she knows what she's talking about. And she said she looked it up. It's black-eyed pea.
Well, I wouldn't go into a Lizard's Thicket then to have breakfast.
Okay. Well, you might leave with a black eye.
That's it. Well, you can tell Al Walker from us. See, they're in South Carolina. You know, it's a different class of people. I just say, don't anybody get upset. I just say that to be funny. I just say it to be funny. But they can say black eye pea, but it's black eye pea. The singing group, I think. What are you doing? Did you just break something in your china? You knocked that horse over. What is this? Oh, you're putting a leveler on here to see if this picture is level. If y'all have heard me tell the story about left brain trying to hang pictures, is it level? No, it's tilting one way. There you go. Do it. No, the wrong way.
Quit rearranging their house. You're sitting on a sofa that looks like it could be houndstooth, but you assure me it is not.
No, Auburn people, no, I'm not sitting on a houndstooth.
You do not sit on black and white houndstooth or wear black and white houndstooth.
No, this
even is. Though we will admit that they've got an awfully good football team and should be a good game coming up the week after next. That's not what I wanted. I want to know if tonight's story you tell will be the same as you did last night.
No, but wait, I got to settle this first. Okay? Oh. It's worse. Yes, there you go. There you go. Is the bubble moving?
Why don't you just look straight?
The middle one looks straight, but the side one now is off. Why don't you take these things down? Okay, no, there you go. The leveler. It's perfect in the middle. It's perfect in the middle.
All right.
Jeanne, just turn your head to the side. Perfect.
Sit at an angle and you'll be fine.
I am. They'll think I've been in the eggnog or something. Something like that. But, okay.
Back to tonight's show.
Okay. Oh, somebody said that? Somebody recognized that?
She's moved on. I'll get her back on it.
The picture behind you is from Rothensburg, Germany. And this person, I think, is the one that when I popped up from here yesterday said, Al must have served. Al was in the military and he was in the Vietnam. He served in Germany. Y'all lived in Germany?
Yeah.
Now why are you coming over here to fix something else? She looked at that picture and she knew where it came from and said, Al and Peg must have been stationed or he served in Germany because that's... Okay. Mary Nell Squire says, all on the wall looks perfect. I don't have a picture in my house that's level. Why does this matter today? I'm not sure. But so why don't we start off by explaining the new system and giving away some prizes here. So we had thousands, I mean thousands of black eyed peas. Nope, it's black eyed, Patrick. Alabama girl here, but an Auburn fan. Okay. You know all of the green... grocery store bags that we draw from for the prizes every day. I threw them all away because it's a new year and they'd gotten into the multi-thousands of and the chances of winning were slim for people. Plus, we would pull out a name and they maybe dropped their name in it last April and then they weren't watching that day and so we thought we'd given it away and nobody called to claim it. And so this happened so much. So we threw everything away, and we told y'all last weekend that if you ask a question or got in touch on Facebook, or that kind of thing, this week we start a new one. Look at your odds. You have better odds of winning today. Because look down in this. This is a regular size little. This is not a humongous bag. This is a little bag. And that's the people that sent in. Now, we also have a bucket because I could not bring the yellow smiley bucket with me. You just can't bring all the stuff on a plane you used to be able to. Now we have a Preds bucket for the day. If you are a hockey fan and you don't pull for the Preds and you don't like them because they've won so much, then I'm sorry, but this is all I could get. See, I'm in their house and I have to kind of do what they say. So these are the really good questions. And when I pull a question and ask it, then your name gets tossed in over here too. So we're changing that. And now some of you said, why don't you just do have new questions every week? Now those people said, do it every month. We will take any suggestion for y'all what to do. All right, I'm moving, rolling my hand. Wife of an Alabama hubby, Roll Tide. Oh, whatever. I'm kidding. That's fine. All right, I don't want to see these. And this is going to be the winner. It will not be the audiobook. We'll give that away later. But you have your choice of all of my stuff. The left brain hat, the left brain book. The book is called Don't Bungee Jump Naked and Other Important Stuff. Or you can have any of the DVDs and CDs. Tony, what is it you said? The one the other day that we pulled out was from Australia.
A little more local.
All right, say it again. How'd you meet it?
Try to be a little more local with your vendors.
How long did you stand in line to send that
book? About 20 minutes, just a little while ago, and filled out all the paperwork. So, but that's fine. We're happy she won, and everything, she actually wanted it. DVD and it's on its way.
Okay. Thank you, Tony. I appreciate it. First winner today, Billy Fonseth, F-O-N-S-E-T-H. So Billy, B-I-L-L-Y, a guy. Billy, what you need to do is go to Tony, T-O-N-I, there it is, Tony at JeannieRobertson.com. Tell Tony what you want. Everything we've got you can choose from, CDs, DVDs, hats, all that kind of stuff. Accept the audiobook, give that away, and she will send it to you. If you want it signed to you, I will be back tomorrow afternoon, and I'll get on that. So that's Billy Fonseth. Okay, normally we try to go into the other buckets and find somebody, but here we are. We just got a few, so here you come. I got the audiobook ordered. Thank you. Elaine Turcotte. Thanks, Elaine. I hope you enjoy it. Give it to somebody who needs to laugh. It's big in nursing homes. Okay, here we go. This winner is Polly, P-O-L-L-Y-E. You don't spend much time respelling that, do you, Polly? Polly Simons McCoy Chupka. Okay. And, this is the one that said, there is a rectangular picture on the wall in your office that I'd like to know what it depicted. Know the one I'm talking about. And then she later said the one. But guess what? Are you in Germany? Here we go again. Polly Simons McCoy Chupka, you have won a prize. First person today, you have won a prize. So so you're it. Call, let Tony know, Tony at Jeanne Robertson, and what you want, everything but the audiobook. And then would you like a black IP? If you want a black IP, I'll put it in your package. But you may have to get me a few extra black IPs, Peter. And now while we're here, let's open up to the question bucket, and I'm going to pull down in here and see what happens here. And this is the person, and this is the question, and the question is Paulette Jones Niles. Question for Saturday: were you known for your sense of humor when you taught physical education in high school? I think so. I'm not saying I was known for my sense of humor in high school. I was one of a small class, and we had some very funny people. But I just thought people that came to my physical education class should enjoy it. And one of the things for young people is to let them know you have a sense of humor, too, instead of always correcting them about everything. Get those clean socks on tomorrow and all this kind of stuff. So we had a good time. Thanks for asking the question, and I'm putting your name into the box for the prizes. Let's go with another question. Al, warm up upstairs. Al's got his guitar out. He wants to sing a song today. Just booted Patrick right off the show. Margie Young Collins. What is your favorite story to tell? I love all of your stories by far. My favorite is don't send your man to the grocery store. Cracks me up every time. My stories are like my children, and you would never choose between the stories. Some are more fun to tell. What we ought to do is, I've thought about this, is let the people on this show select the top 20 stories or the top 10. I know this is like saying on Andy Griffith, who's your favorite person? You have to take off Barney and Floyd and maybe Andy, because everybody's going to say them, and everybody says the grocery store, but I like a lot of the other stories. By the way, the story on, I can't even think of the name of it, the bodysuit story, don't snap an elephant to the tree. I stopped telling that story when I broke my femur because I think I need to be standing to tell that story. And so now I'm back to telling it, and I love to tell that story. I also love to tell the baton story. I love to tell the magnetic personality story about Jane Taylor. I like them all. But that might be fun. I sort of know what everybody's going to say. Don't send a man to the grocery store. But I also love to tell bungee jump. When you say which is the favorite, your reaction is always bigger if the crowd has not heard the story, or if they love it so much they're just mouthing along with you. So, Margie, my favorite story, I don't want to hurt any of the story's feelings. So, I don't know. I'm going to put you in your draw for a prize. Let me get another question out of here. See, we don't have so many to choose from this week. This is wonderful. The next question is from Judy Ellis. Okay, here you go, Peg. Have you ever considered writing another book? What is the title? Peg had just graduated, we call it, well, she retired from teaching speech on the collegiate level. And she was, if you'll notice in the back of the book, one of the people that I thanked profusely for helping with the book, and it's really going over well. I have considered writing another book because we only use 40-some stories in this book, and we have already written about 140. And so people have said, you didn't put the baton story in the book. You didn't put this one in the book. We didn't want to put all of them in that book. We thought we had a good book. And so, yes, I have thought about it. If you got a good title, send it in. But I'm putting you in there. Okay, one more question, and then Al, I want you to sing. All right, here's a question. And it is from David Pummel, P-U-M-M-I-L-L. Jeanne, how do you fix, in quotation marks, he's learned a good Southern word, how do you fix a peanut butter and jelly sandwich? These are critical questions that will save the world population here. I always say there's a difference. I don't cook. Everybody knows I don't cook, but I do fix. And fix, an example is peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. And David wants to know if I do creamy or crunchy. I do creamy because it's less calories than the peanuts. What kind of jelly and bread? Whatever kind of bread is still in there, not hadn't molded yet. And what kind of jelly, whatever's in the refrigerator, do you mash it all together? I do once I get it on, I take that top piece and put it down, mash on it. And sometime, and the left brain likes this, I mix it all up in the bowl. And then I put it in. Are you laughing? Okay. Then David Pummel says, watch the shows. I've watched every one. So, hey, David, sorry we didn't get to see you in Palm Desert in November. I am sorry, too, Palm Desert show. I would say it's one of the ones that have been postponed, but a whole lot of them have been postponed. And if you want to know what shows are still active, because they're still coming up, go to JeanneRobertson.com, which is my website, and then there's a place that has all of the shows. We're still selling tickets. It's amazing to me. And people wait. I think Nashville, Florida is coming up, and that's in the panhandle of Florida. And I don't remember, two or three other places. But some people are just holding on the tickets. We will be back. I can promise you, we will all be back. It'll work out. Okay. I wanted to, since Patrick's not here and Al Kyle thinks he's a right good singer, doesn't he?
Big. Yes.
And he opens the songs for me. We don't have an opening act. I don't want to hurt your feelings, Al, but we don't really have an opening act, and here's why. When I go to a show, I don't really want to watch an opening act. It has to be special, like we've had Debbie Childers open for me, and we've had Tara Brown do a little opener, 10 minutes, because they won spots in the contest that I had. And out in Salt Lake City, Karen Ruth White did the same thing because she had won the contest that year. But then if you add another 20 or 30 minutes on the program, you have to take a longer intermission. Everybody's got to go to the bathroom. It just works well for me to just get on out there if y'all come to see me. But Al McCree, when he is with us, he and Peg travel with me a lot, and he will come out and sing the Butterbean song. Takes him 5 or 6 minutes, but it lets him make some announcements that we need. Like before COVID, he would always say, "I will be in the lobby till the last person leaves." Sometime one night he said, "I'll be there till 1 a.m. if it takes it." I came right out and said, "I'm not going to be out there at 1 a.m. And but he gets in some information and says, "We're taking your pictures. If you don't want to be on Jeanne's Facebook, don't get in the pictures." So I asked him today to sing the Butterbean song since we're here, and he has his guitar. And also, I think he's got a special twist on it. Listen carefully, and if you hear it, type it in that you heard it. So, Al, can you hear me upstairs?
I can. Thank you.
Yeah. Oh, look. That's my husband right behind you. Jeanne Robertson right in there. Sing away.
Just a bowl of Butterbeans. Pass the cornbread, if you please. I don't want no collard greens. All I want is a bowl of butter beans. I've been lucky enough to be with Jeanne around the country for the last 10 years. I haven't been in every show, but I've been in a lot of them. And when I'm there, I always open with butter beans. And it goes something like this. Some of you out there recognize the tune to this song because you are churchgoers. Some of you out there pretending to be churchgoers so you can pretend to recognize the tune to this song. I'll give you the words and you can sing along. Here we go. Bread and gravy, that's all right. Bread and gravy, that's all right. Turnip sandwich, a delight. Turnip sandwich, a delight. But my children all still scream. But my children all still scream for another bowl of butter bean. See the lady sitting there. See the lady sitting there. She looks like she's filled with air. She looks like she's filled with air. She's not pregnant like she seems. She's not pregnant like she seems. She's just a bowl of butter beans. When I lay my bones to rest, when I lay my bones to rest, plant no rose upon my chest. Plant no rose upon my chest. Plant no blooming evergreen. Plant no blooming evergreen. All I want is a bowl of butter beans. My little harmony out there now, just a bowl of butter beans. Just a bowl of butter beans. Pass the cornbread, if you please. Pass the cornbread, if you please. I don't want no black-eyed peas. I don't want no black-eyed peas. All I want is a bowl of butter beans. All I want is a bowl of butter, good old butter beans.
Okay, thank you, Al. You can come back to here. It was a little bit, we had a little bit of the problems on there, but since after every show, you email quickly and tell Patrick and me what went wrong on that show. That's okay. Just don't worry about it. It's fine. Thank you for singing the song, and it helps at the show.
I do want to interrupt you just a minute and let people know that there are lots of rescheduling going on. And the best way to find out when the show's going to be is on Jeanne's website. We'll keep that up to date. So go to the JeanneRobertson.com, open to the public, and we'll keep that up to date as much as we can. Like the Palm Desert show that was mentioned earlier, it's now going to be in January of 2022. So we're just having to reschedule. There are two upcoming shows, one in Nashville that Jeanne talked about. There's another one in Tallahassee that's coming up as well. But we'll just, by all means, buy your tickets at the link through Jeanne's website. Please don't Google Jeanne Robertson. Go to one of those secondary sites, because one of those secondary sites, you're going to pay way too much money. So please don't do that. Just go to Jeanne's Open to the Public site, use that link, and you'll have great, you'll get the right ticket price at the right venue.
Okay, I'm going to double what he said, because people that don't go through the venue get the ticket through a secondary source. Then the show gets postponed. They're not notified, because the venue doesn't have their name to notify them. Or if they say, I can't go on the date you've postponed it to, the secondary source will not give you your money back. So play it smart. People have called and said, I think you were really funny, but $400 for a ticket. We go, $400? Why would you pay? He said, well, we got two tickets of $200 each. And it turns out we were selling them for what, $59, $49, something like that. So play it smart. And that's not just with our show. That's with everybody's show. So play it smart when you can. All right. Thanks, Al. I'm going to give away some more prizes.
Thank you, Jeanne.
Okay, here we go right here. This is going to be for a prize. I'm reaching down in this bucket right here. And the winner is Martha Newbern from Florence, Alabama. Martha Newbern, V-E-R-N-N-E-W-B, from Florence, Alabama. Martha, do you know Charles Barkley? Because he's from down there in Leeds, Alabama, originally, and he's down there. I just want to meet him so badly, and I'm looking for anybody that knows him. So if you know him, Martha, let me know. You win a prize. Tell Tony exactly what you say. Kathy Seville, bring on the vaccine, then the shows can happen. And I am going to take a vaccine. I called this week to find out how to get in line at my age and all of that, because you don't want to cut line in front of the important people. And I was told that my doctor nor the druggist had the information yet. But left brain, because he's so sick, he is on target in a couple of weeks. So that makes me feel good. And they're doing the best they can. And I have friends who say they're not going to take it, and that's fine. I'll use theirs right there. This is a question. No, I need to do another prize. Not having a guess. I wonder how many prizes we're going to give away today. This is also for a prize, and it is from, oh, my gosh, Louise Schwendendemann. Now, Louise, you might not remember this, but I do. I know who you are. You're taller than I am. Of course, I'm shrinking. And you're from Kentucky originally. And when I had a show at the Dollhouse House in Louisville, usually now we go to the Brown Theater, but we were at the Dollhouse House for, I was speaking to somebody. You came up and you said to me, I'll never forget it. You said, my name is Louise. I know you wear a size 11 shoe. And if you will get in the car with me in 20 minutes, I will take you to a place in this town that you can buy size 11 shoes. I didn't bat an eye. I said, let me go up to the room and get my credit card. And now, what is this? Brent Van Hook. Okay, thank you. And then, you know, we went out and shop for shoes that afternoon. It was so much fun. But we're both tall, and she knew I had trouble getting shoes too. So, Louise, now I'm going to pay you back, it looks like. You know how to get in touch with Tony, and you can choose whatever you want. I'm sorry if you already got everything. I apologize. Get something. Use it for a gift. All right. That's the prize. I put it over here. Would you like a black IP? Anybody that wants a black IP in their place, I'm trying to get all the black IPs out of here. So I'll be glad to send that. Okay. Way to go, Al. Thanks a lot. All right. I'm going to go down in here for another question that y'all sent in this week. And the question is, Daniel Pentecost, is there a story that you used to tell And then it got cut off. I guess so. Peg, we were cutting these things as fast as we could last night. Did he say that you no longer tell?
Yes.
I think so. We'll probably find the end of that in a little while. I remember that. Are there stories that you just used to tell you that, yeah, they this is a way to put it to speakers, to tell younger speakers. If you have a speech that tells all about story examples from World War One or World War Two, you might be using phrases they don't know anything about. So you might make sure that your audience knows. I have some stories that I used to tell that I believe in today's world. I never said bad words and I never used the inappropriate terms for different races, religions, all like that. But I had a story that I told about a real tall person. And I became aware that I didn't think that fit anymore. But when I started telling it, everybody thought it was a true story. And they laughed and told. So you put them aside. The real reason you put stories aside is you get better stories. And I'm always trying to work in every time I do something longer than the Grand Ole Opry, of course. But if you can, because you don't get much time, if you've got a regular speech or you're doing your own show, when you do your own show, you got an hour and a half, do whatever you want. I always try a new story. And the one secret, if you're interested in speaking, is I have a place in my program that I can always drop a story. And then behind it, I have a story that's a surefire winner. So that if it doesn't really go over that first or second time, you've got something that you know grabs the audience back. So during the COVID, I've been working hard on new stories, and I've got some good ones. Don't you think I have some good ones?
You do the cat?
Well, I don't know. I'm not. I am quite finished that. But maybe I will if I sit here long enough today. But what I found out when I did the Charleston show about a month ago, on the November, we streamed worldwide. We streamed. I didn't think it was as much fun as a regular show because the crowd. Well, first of all, they said we'll sell 250 tickets, and people just would not come. And then when I got there that night, you said, I think we got 69 people. Then later, how many people were there? You told 45. Me.
45.
45 people were sitting in this huge theater. I knew there weren't 65. It just wasn't as much fun for me to do. But when I did stories that I've used before a lot. And the reason I did was my viewing audience, the people who follow me, y'all, has increased so much because of these shows during COVID that I have a lot of people that have never heard of, been to a show, haven't seen me perform or anything. And what I have not had is shows to practice the stories and get the timing down pat. It takes about a year of telling a story to get it where I wouldn't mind having it filmed. Because then I'm thinking this is might be as good as it's going to get. And then the next week you put a line in that's really funny. And you say, oh, I wish I had that tape. So Daniel Pentecost, that's a good question. I'll put you in over here with your first half. And we may find your second half as the bucket goes on. Let's ask another question. And here it is. Hey, we thought we'd done so well. We cut up questions all night. See, at home I have a paper cutter. We don't have a paper cutter. You need a paper cutter. I think I'm going to give you a paper cutter for Christmas, late Christmas. Okay. Ian McLean, McLean. I think it's Ian. And I can tell you without even looking at this, you're from Scotland because you are so kind to listen a lot. And we know what you do. And I think this is me answering you. And you emailed and wanted to know if we had gotten the devil double wide home at Apache campground down at the beach. I don't have that question in front of me right now, but that was what you said. And you said that you were a person who y'all tour around in RVs and do that kind of thing too over there in Scotland. And do you want to know if I ever got my double wide? If you listen to the story about left brain, a penny for your thoughts, it is a clip on YouTube called A Penny for Your Thoughts. You will see that that I talk about the fact that we have a manufactured housing at the Apache campground, ground in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina. And we have for years. Absolutely. And I think I dropped a comment in one of the tapes early on. If I can sell enough of these DVDs, I'm going to get a double wide. And so what Ian had written was to ask, and I don't have it here, but I remember he said, did you ever get that double wide? Yes, we did. It's got cathedral ceilings and three bedrooms. And y'all remember Neil Steele, the radio guy from up in Virginia, Gloucester, Virginia, and I'm on his show all the time. And he said he wants to know if he can go down there sometime because we get it every other week and we can use it. And by the way, we own it with my sister, Catherine. And I mean, we all get involved, the whole family. And I just got, thank you, Peg, for bringing this over there. Catherine wanted me to know that she is on watching this today. Hey, Catherine, do you remember how you would eat those black-eyed peas by the bowl full while I was sitting there struggling with one pea about to throw up, sitting there till 4 o'clock in the afternoon? You kept walking by saying, I ate all my black-eyed peas. You were. I love you, Catherine, but you shouldn't have done that. So this is what Ian McLean says. I wrote back and I said to him, because I get up at 5 o'clock and start working about every day. And then he's texting me about the double wide. And I wrote back and said, what time is it there? And you wrote back and said, 12 o'clock midday. Well, actually, 12:04 to be precise. Can you say left brain? 12:04 to be precise. And then you say, happy hog manny. What is a hog manny? Is it pork day over in Scotland? I would like to know this, Ian. Write us and tell us. Happy hog manny. H-O-G. Like a big hog, man, M-A-N-A-Y, happy hog man. I do not know what that means, Ian. That is, and in Scotland, y'all aren't too confusing. I'm supposed to know that. Put you in here to draw for a prize. Then Tony will fuss about it. I had to stand in line an hour and a half, you see. Okay, here's another question right here. And it is, hello from South Carolina. Enjoyed seeing you in Sumter or your helpers lining up to take you to the Opry. See, these questions just came in this week. Have you been to the Opry before and how do you pick your stories for your shows? Okay, I have been to the Opry thanks to Al McCree sitting right here. He books me onto the Grand Ole Opry. And we were supposed to have two shows there last April and then the COVID. They kept having singers because they wanted to go every week and not have a black Grand Ole Opry, no lights, no shows. And but I don't know how many humorists they've had, but they're bringing us back. And we went last night. You booked me again here and tonight. So
do you have the name of the person who sent the question?
The person is Carol S. Matney, M-A-T-N-E-Y. And Carol, how do you pick the shows? For example, I thought I had 15 minutes last night, so I selected to tell the Garth Brooks story. That is, you don't know Garth Brooks. That's the way we pronounce the title of that because of left brain. And also, then I was going to tell a story about the achy breaky heart and what happened in the ladies' restroom. And I had it perfectly timed out. As it turned out, the show started running late. And when we got on right before I went out, they said, cut to this many minutes. So I didn't get to do that. So tonight I'll probably do. But I chose those stories because they revolve around the Grand Ole Opry and country music and the Opryland Hotel. Something that happened there was the one I didn't get to tell. Got a note here. Okay. Hogmanay is the Scottish New Year's Eve. They eat their black eyed peas on New Year's Eve, along with pork. I'll guarantee you. Am I the only one? Here it is right here. Janet Quirt. Hogmanay is a New Year's Eve celebration. Hogmanay is a, here we go. Becky Isler. See, this is an educational show. Hogmanay is the Scots word for the last day of the year, and it's synonymous with the celebration of the new year in a Scottish manner. It is normally followed by further celebration on the morning of New Year's Day in some cases. Sometimes they'll go to January 7th. Oh, they're drinking a lot here. This is a Scottish bank holiday. That's from Wikipedia. Well, thank you. Now, who's going to help me remember next year to wish Ian and all of my Scottish friends a happy Hogmanay? And am I pronouncing it the right way? See, I've learned that. Don't lose this.
I'll help you remember.
Oh, great. There, keep that. And you pick the stories for your shows. And one other question, because I know this person and they ask a lot about speaking. When you have not been to a town and you're doing a theater, you can just do anything. But if you have been and you're doing a repeat, say 2 years later, which we love to go back, you don't want to tell the same stories. And then 4 years later, you don't want to tell the same. So I'm lucky enough to keep, as long as I can keep working on new stories. I mean, that one I told you about, yes, that's going to be a good story with the cat. And you try to select those stories. After it's been about 8 or 10 years, people come up and they say, you didn't tell the grocery store. I've heard you speak 4 times and you didn't tell bungee jumping. You didn't. So you try to work them in. But what you do is you keep records so that when you go back, say you're not going to a theater show, you're going to a convention. And they basically have the same people that come every year. You really don't want to go back. Here's what I've learned a long time ago. You want to go back, but you don't want to go back and tell the same stories. They might not be able to tell you what you told a few years ago. But when they hear the same stories, they say, that's the same stuff she did when she was here before. So you don't want to be that. Patrick, are you still there? Punch the button.
I'm here.
Would you agree with that? You have to tell some stories and sing some songs, but it's better to always have something new or not.
No, absolutely.
Well, thank you for expounding on that. You know what we tell contestants in pageants is don't ever answer with yes or no. Can you keep the conversation going?
Yes. So
absolutely, you are. Yes. Thank you. Goodbye, Patrick. Well, that got me nowhere fast. The pictures are probably get crooked behind me on the wall too. So what am I going to do the rest of the day? I'm going to hang up from this in a few minutes. I'm going back to bed. I'm going to sleep until 4:30 and then we go back to the thing. All right. Then I'm going to put this name, Carol Matinee. And Carol, you opened up a whole, there you go. Hoot man. All right. This is not a prize. This is a question. And this question is from Brent Cowell. This is tough. Well, this is too tough. This is over my pay grade. What has been your favorite year in your lifetime? My favorite. Well, it's not this year. It's not this year. We've eliminated 2020. My favorite year.
Excuse me. That was last year.
Well, that was last year. You're right. Oh gosh. I've got to remember to change my checks, the dates. I had a really good year in 63 because I met Left Brain in June and we started dating. And then in July, I became Miss North Carolina. And that let me drop out of school for a year, Auburn, and stay home and travel, which let Left Brain and I date any day that I could be home. And then when the year was over, from June to June that year, 63, 64. Then I gave 500 little speeches in that year, and you can't buy that kind of an opportunity. And I was very fortunate, and I was just having the most fun. And Left Brain and I were just so in love. And that lasted for a while, and then we went different ways, and then we got back together. Okay, that's my favorite year. Okay, we're going to now give away, Brett, I'm putting you in here. You sent in several good ones. I'm going to give away now the only one of these that we'll give away today. Because we're pushing this one right now. You can tell. Ta-da! This is the audiobook. And this has 7 CDs. And it's me reading the paperback book. And it's with my accent and that kind of thing. This is great for a long trip. It's great if you have somebody that can't see to read the book anymore. But another great place we have discovered in the last 2 or 3 weeks because of people telling us, if you have a nursing home situation, maybe where they bring people all in a room at one time and you play this and somebody's reading it to them. It would be me. That's working real well too. And Patrick, are you there, Patrick? You know what?
I'm here.
All right. A lot of people in the questions want to know, I announced earlier this week who the three people were going to be on that we've invited to be on in January.
Yeah.
And we got very excited. And I mentioned that one weekend we didn't have anybody yet. We were still working on it. And they said, we want to see the closet. Tell them about the closet because Patrick produced this. Tell them what it is.
Well, so when we decided to do an audio version of the book, we I started looking at studio time, and I just started thinking this could be a really long and expensive experience in a studio. And so I said, Jeanne, I think we can do this ourselves because I know some editing and I have some software on my computer. And so we decided to give it a try. We went in almost every room in the house and I kept hearing lights buzzing or I could hear people outside. And we ended up in Jeanne's closet. And as soon as I walked in, the sound became perfect. And I said, Jeanne, we're going to do this in the closet. And we laughed. But for the next how many weeks, we recorded in that closet.
And then I lost my voice in the middle of it. And we had to wait till I came back and all that. But the closet used to be Beaver's bedroom. So I had taken Beaver's bedroom 2 years ago, maybe three. Because we didn't want him to come back. It's 54 for Pete's sake. And turned his bedroom into a closet. And everybody in town kept saying, "You've taken away a bedroom. I said, "Well, I put in a Murphy bed in there, and I fixed it so it could come down." And they kept saying, "But you've devalued your house when you take away a bedroom." And I said, there's no woman in this county who wouldn't see this closet and not have to see the rest of the house. They'll want this big closet. So it has a packing station. And Patrick was set up over there with that stuff. And I was set up over here. And we would read it and correct it. And it did real well. So we're going to give one away right now. And were you going to say something else?
No, I was just going to say, I want people to know it was a very big closet.
Speaking to the microphone, you're standing on my foot.
There was a lady named Liz Curtis Higgs. Oh, I should have Liz Curtis Higgs on the show. And she's an author. Many of you know her, and she is a funny lady. And she wanted to interview me. And she wanted to interview me at the National Speakers Association meeting. And I said, Liz, I am so tired at that meeting, as we all are. I said, if you will let me wait a week or two, I will fly to Louisville and we'll do this at your house. And she said, that would be great. And we went in there. Her children were making so much noise. We got in this tiny closet. She's a large woman. I'm a large woman. And we couldn't see. There was one little light. But we did the interview. And we shut out the children's noise. All right, let's give this away. And I hope somebody wins it. Oops, wrong. Yeah, it comes out of this bag. And I'm doing around because people say, I don't think you go to the bottom of the basket. And I don't think, all right, here is the winner of the audiobook. Okay. We have, oh, just great. See, people always say, Aaron and Wendy Lynch from Burlington, North Carolina, which is where I live. Andy and Wendy Lynch. Patrick, do you know them? You don't know them? Good.
Do they live next door to you?
No. No. Aaron and Wendy. Oh, if you just come by the house, we won't have to ship it. We can save money on shipping. So that's good. Let's go back to some more. Am I missing something you want to say? Peg, do you want to say? Peg, you want to tell them about the time we were trying to get to York, Pennsylvania? Peg was traveling with me, and it said, you come to a fork in the road. This is listening to the system. Pitch dark, 11 or 12 o'clock at night. We drove there after the previous show, didn't we? It left at night. We had no business doing that, Peg. Sure. I think I was the one that said, if we wait till morning, the car might break down. And this was last year. And all of a sudden it said, take a left in the Y in the road. And right in front of us was a fire truck stopped, telling everybody, don't take a left, go the other way. And we didn't know where we were. Wasn't that a fun night? Yeah. I remember just draping myself across the counter and telling the woman, I'm so glad to be in this hotel. All right, here we go. Cynthia Necht Masters. Cynthia is spelled the way we know, but Necht is K-N-E-C-H-T Masters. How did you decide to call your show The Back Porch Show? Well, we were on the back porch. And we said, Eureka, Have I got an idea? Well, it just see, are there a lot of trolls today? Somebody said we will try to get them off, and I apologize for them.
I'm battling hard over here. Every time they pop up from Nigeria, I'm knocking them down.
Okay. You know, y'all, I'm so sorry. These people are not the names. They make up a different names 3 and 4 a week, and we quickly ban them. We hide every comment they've made and click them off, and then they're gone. But what they do is they switch names. But y'all, if the thing starts off with, have I told you that you're beautiful? And this is somebody from the internet telling you this, then beware. Let your antenna go up unless you think you're particularly pretty. Because remember, they can't see you. So how do they know that you're beautiful? And then you say, they'll say, I would give anything if you would friend me. I think we can be friends. No, they can't friend you. So don't get involved. And then Patrick and I spend a lot of time getting rid of these people. And it's an irritating thing. You think they're trying to sell us something in the long run and make a friend?
But bear in mind, Jeanne, worldwide, this stream is in the top 20 every week. So you got a lot of people that are watching you.
I forgot that.
And that attracts.
Did y'all know that? Every week, Polestar puts out
a chart
of who's been. And I'm in the top 20.
Always in the top 20, sometimes in the top 10.
I know. It depends on the guest. Depends on whether we have it. Whatever. Okay. So Cynthia Neck Masters, it just seems silly to call it front stoop when we were on the back porch. And so that's what we called it. And that's where we've been every day unless I was in Sumter or I was at the beach. The question is, the people that are asking, if when you start traveling, are you going to do this? Well, we're trying to practice it today. If you'll notice, with the computers, not all the fancy cameras and things, it worked pretty. I think it worked. The sound was a little tinty on from upstairs in your office with the guitar, but I thought it sounded good. But the we're learning. And so there could be a way that I could do this backstage before a show. And we're working on it. The truth is, if you want to say what's good about the last year, for me, I've stretched a lot, but also meeting all y'all. And I really made some friends here, and I see the same names coming across, and I appreciate it. And this question is, will Left Brain ever join you? Left Brain is very sick. There's always somebody with him when I'm not there. He loves for me to travel, and he always has, and he went with me so many times. But right now, it's just not going to work, and I appreciate your thoughts and prayers. Okay, thanks a lot. Okay, appreciate that note. All right, now let me get another question right here. Do you have a 3-minute story?
That's not me. I'm not the storyteller.
Okay, here is another question. Look at these. Okay, Liliani, Leilani, Medlin. Hello from Pinehurst, North Carolina. Love all your stories. I listen to you every morning to get my laugh. One of my favorite stories is, don't bungee jump naked. What is your favorite one to tell? Well, we sort of covered that lately. When I start telling a story and it's going over, that right there, that day, that minute, that is my favorite story to tell. And when I do a new one and they love it, I'm so happy. I'm going to get another one out over here. And we'll do these for next. I'm just sitting here covered in little pieces of paper. Here's a question. And the question is, Kathy Saville, S-A-V-I-L-L-E, from Covington, Virginia. A question for your yellow bucket. Is there anything you do prior to a speech to help you get ready to go? Traditions and so forth. Superstition? Nah. No, I don't have any of those. Thank you for keeping us laughing. But I'll tell you what, if I haven't told a story in a long time, when I'm in the bed, because sleeping is one of my hobbies. Yeah, when I'm there, I got it figured out. What are you going to do? I know. Got it. Thank you. So what was I saying? So I'll turn on my own YouTube clip, and I'll probably fall asleep before I get through it. But it reminds me of one or two words or sentences that if they don't go in. For example, if I'm telling the story, you don't know Garth Brooks. If by chance I leave out Left Brain saying, me saying to left brain, we have airline tickets, and because he wants to see a Nat King Cole concert, and the man's been dead since the 60s. And I said, and I can tell you this, I've got a lot of airline miles, but when he died, I don't know if he went up to heaven or down the other way. We don't have enough airline miles to get to a Nat King Cole concert. If I leave out that sentence, I get to the end of the story and I have a punchline that makes no sense at all. So you got to say, what lines do I have to get in to make sure that this story is going to work? And if you haven't told it in a long time, like over Christmas break, which this year was what? 9 months. And if you do that, then you got to just say, now make sure to get that in. You got to make sure to get that in, because you can't go back at right before the punchline and say, oh, what I meant to tell you was this. You'll get this. So our hour has passed. Patrick, are you there?
I'm here.
It reminds me of the time you went to Gainesville. Three or four nights before, you had been speaking and people crowding around, buying your stuff, singing, doing all that. You drove me to Gainesville, Georgia, and were sitting behind the table selling my product. So you wanted to say, I do this too. I'm very funny too. I do a good job. But thanks for doing this, and Tony too, and Patrick and Peg and all of these. And,
that's the owl over there. I'm Patrick.
What?
You said Patrick and Peg.
I know it. Well, Patrick goes with Leslie.
Yes.
That's over here. And Peg goes with Al. I go with left brain.
That's right.
We all go with having a good time and keeping a sense of humor. And whatever you do this first week of this year, look for humor. Next week on the 9th, we have a guest. That's Karen Mills, isn't it? Whoa. Whoa, whoa. I will start playing her clips of Karen's, and I've been on her show. For this coming week, if you don't know this funny woman, you're just going to love her. Then a couple of weeks after that, we have Jane Jenkins Herlong, and then toward the end of the month, Shonda Pierce. So if anybody, these are great people, I appreciate them coming. But if anybody knows Charles Barkley, could you please tell him there's an old woman, real old woman, sick. I'm sick. And then I went to Auburn, and I just think he's the funniest person. I just want to meet him so badly and interview him. So help me out if you can. We'll talk to y'all, and for Pete's sake, keep laughing.
She's a heck of a lot of fun, Jeanne Robertson. Oh, she's a heck of a lot of fun, Jeanne Robertson.